of Light, Ancestral Wisdom by a Hawaiian Shaman. Before we get to Hank, I want to talk with you just a little bit about the spiritual broadcasting company and the spiritual but not religious show, what we're doing, why we're doing it, and what we hope to accomplish. You know, there's a huge movement going on now, I believe, is a spiritual revolution.
Take about 20, 30 pounds of bananas up to the supermarket and sell them because I can't eat them all.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, you know, we've got avocados, we've got mangoes, we've got papayas, we've got breadfruit, we've got a kitchen garden for the kitchen, we've got an edible hedge from Borneo where you just trim the hedge and throw it right in the wok and steam it and eat it.
Oh, wow.
That kind of thing.
Wow. How much land do you have there?
Well, I've only got an acre, but I'm telling you, in the tropics, keeping up with the weeding of an acre of land is a hero's journey. All of your gardeners are going to appreciate that. You're in Florida, aren't you? Aren't you, George?
Yes, I am. I am.
Yeah. Well, so you know, you're in the tropics like I am.
Well, you know, I'm actually we're in the subtropics, and we're about 100 miles north of the real tropics. We're here in Sarasota. I used to live in Fort Myers, which is about halfway between. It's amazing what 100, 120 miles will, you know,
yes,
different.
Indeed.
Oh, yeah,
yeah.
Make a huge difference.
Well, where I live, it looks like Tahiti. I know it's tough, but somebody's got to live there.
Somebody has to live there. I really envy the fact that you're going to be growing food. I grow some things out on my back.
here in New York, in which we are literally seeking out people who have a very interesting program on their inner hard drive. Now, I think of this as a program because when that program is double-clicked with the right mouse, and you can use hallucinogens to do it, but I use the drum, I use the rattle, which are played in a theta brainwave pattern. And what I've discovered is that with very little lead-in, non-tribal Western people can respond very strongly to this sound and go off on these visionary adventures, returning with accounts that would pass muster at any Aboriginal campfire. Now, this is very interesting to me, especially with relation to what you said about the transformational community.
Right.
The fact is that, you know, people are leaving our mainstream religions in droves.
Oh, yeah.
Now, you know, those people have been going to the same church for 75 years. They're not going to stop doing that. But what's happening is the next generation and the generation after them who are coming along are interested in different things and different kinds of spirituality. And so there is this real impetus in Western society today towards alternative, non-Western forms of spirituality. And this is part of the change which is happening right now.
Well, you know, when you talk about the theta that you're using, I made a CD with theta in the background embedded in surf, and the surf has been very, I mean, I got a lot of CDs out there, and it's like, it just brings you into that experience very quickly that you might have to meditate for a very long time to get the kind of experiences you're talking about.
Well, it does, you know, and this is why I think that there is definitely a genetic program on our DNA, which when that program is double-clicked with the right mouse, it allows us to expand our conscious awareness dramatically, which draws us into perceiving in an expanded way. Now, this was part of what drew me into connection with this kahuna elder here in Hawaii, which is the subject of this new book, The Bowl of Light. This was a man who was descended from King Kamehameha on his mother's side and another high, very, very famous high chief on his father's side, which means that, you know, everybody in Polynesia knew this guy from Easter Island to New Zealand to Tahiti. I mean, when this guy would get off the plane, he'd get mobbed at the airport, kind of like the Dalai Lama.
Really?
He was like the Dalai Lama of Polynesia. And in fact, he sat on stage with the Dalai Lama in New York at the United Nations.
Wow.
So this was a guy who was very, very well known. And my wife, Jill, and I were drawn into connection with him during the last 8 years of his life. During this time, he had this extraordinary body of knowledge, which he decided to share with me. And that's really what this book, The Bowl of Light, is all about, the teachings from the deep wisdom of the kahuna mystics of Polynesia that he brought forward and decided to share. And, you know, let me just say this without casting judgment. This is far and beyond any of the books on Huna, which are out there in the bookstores right now.
Really?
This is not a book about Huna.
Right.
Well, this is a book about the true kahuna mystical tradition. And so, you know, I'm very excited about it because Makua saw this as part of a plan that he and I were sort of hatching together. And the plan involved bringing people together and creating connection. Initially, you know, it involved those conditions, those situations, which involved the expansion of humankind's consciousness at large. And secondly, it's about, you know, all the spiritual elders, all the kahunas, all the mystics, all the gurus, all the teachers, bringing their friends, family members, acolytes, initiates, students, bringing them all together to create connection. Because this is what's really necessary in this time. The time of separation is over, and the time of connection is beginning.
Well, you know, that's one of the biggest problems we have with our major religions is their exclusivity rather than inclusiveness, and we really need inclusiveness and love, real love.
Yeah, everybody's pulling in their own direction. It's the old paradigm. It's been going on for the last 2,000 years, and, you know, it's over. You know, that's the best way to put it. It's over. And we're coming to the end of this cycle of ages. A lot of people think that it's going to happen around the year 2012, and it may very well do that. But it's not so much the year 2012 that's important. It's 2013. because that's when the next cycle begins.
I think.
And if the last cycle, as Makua was fond of saying, if the last cycle was 26,000 years, I mean, when we're talking about the next cycle of ages, we're talking about a substantial chunk of temporal real estate, you could say.
Huh.
And what we decide to build on that new foundation now is going to determine the life ways and the spiritual practice of humanity at large for the next several thousand years. That's not a small thing.
No, and we're laying the groundwork for that now.
Yeah, well, this is what you guys are doing.
Yeah,
you know,
absolutely.
You and all the others who have programs like this are creating a kind of crossroads where we can really come together and meet and share and bring all of our people together. And this is such important work, I can't tell you.
Well, there's never been a time like this in history, Hank. This is really unique times. And there's that Chinese thing that says, may you be blessed with living in interesting times. And we are that, you know.
Yeah, clever, these Chinese.
Yeah, not only clever, but they're really patient. I know that for sure. Hey, you do a lot of workshops. You actually you do workshops in the Frank Lloyd Wright house there on Hawaii?
Well, we used to. The house actually was sold.
It went into
sad. The house was sold.
Didn't the bank get it?
The bank had it
in an REO back in May of 2006. A year ago, 2010.
You were there?
No, I just know about it.
Well, you know, there's a new book that's come out about it, which was written by my friend Sandy Sims, who actually created it. And you know, the book is called something like How Frank Lloyd Wright Got Inside My Head and Changed Everything Around. It's a wonderful book about the building of this house. And that's where we used to do our workshops, but then it was sold back in 2000. So after that time, we worked in other places. But the interesting thing about this kahuna mystic is that he came to look us over. You know, he'd read my first book, Spirit Walker.
He came to your workshops?
Many of your listeners are aware, this is the book about how I went crazy in Hawaii.
Right.
Began to have all these visions.
Right.
Well, you know, he came to look me over to see if I was real. And when he saw what we were doing, when he realized that Jill and I, my wife and I, were creating these programs specifically to help non-tribal Western people develop the mystic in themselves, to get themselves in touch with their inner sources of wisdom and power, he saw us as part of this plan that he called the Ancestral Grand Plan.
Right.
And this is really what drew us together.
Well, you know, one of the things that that he talks about that I'm really interested in hearing your take on this, and that you say in your book that genealogy is everything.
Yes.
You know, if that's the case, that really leaves me out in the cold, because my genealogical background is bleak, to say the least. I don't have that that kingship or any of that in that I'm aware of in my background. So, I mean, how does that, you know, and I think you also talk about democracy. He makes a statement that democracy, you know, really doesn't work, and that, you know, that how does all that square with you know, the transformational movement, and the, you know, because it's really pretty democratically geared.
Well, this is a conversation that we had right at the beginning of the book. In fact, it was the first real deep conversation that we had.
Right.
In which we're sitting right at the edge of a volcano crater, an active volcano crater.
Is that the one by your house?
Well, he considered this place his office, and so we're sitting there talking. And, you know, we began to talk about genealogy, because in Polynesia, genealogy is everything. It determines who you are. It determines your mana, which means your personal power, as well as your ike, which is your spiritual power. And it really defines you. So he was, you know, aware of the fact that I was aware that he was descended from Kamehameha through Kamehameha's third wife. He was a seventh-generation direct descendant of Kamehameha the Great. And so, you know, I was telling him a little bit about my own genealogy as well. Now, your genealogy, this is a very interesting thing, because I found in my workshops that most Western people here in North America have a very unclear understanding of their genealogy. Most people cannot talk about their ancestors back beyond their grandparents,
right,
or their great-grandparents. I mean, it just doesn't exist. And part of this is because most of us came to North America trying to escape an oppressive class system in Europe.
Yes, yes.
Which had a glass ceiling. And, you know, there was the potato famine in Ireland, where a million Irish died while Queen Victoria and her cabinet sat on their thumbs and did nothing to help them.
Right.
I mean, these people were getting away from the past. And so there was a kind of a denial, I think, that happened, where most Americans really don't know very much about that their ancestors or their ancestral lineages. I was fortunate because my father was a New York attorney, a 12th generation New Yorker.
Oh, wow.
So he had a lot of pride in his ancestry. And when I was a boy, he used to fill me with these stories about our ancestry. And so I was able to reiterate this knowledge for Chief Makua. I call him Chief because he was a high chief.
Right.
He was born a high chief. And so this was part of the bond between the two of us. Both Makua, the kahuna, both Makua and I were descended from a long line of chiefs, of rulers. And this was part of what brought us together. And so, you know, here in America, in North America, most of us are seeking to remember who we actually are. But, you know, it's a real burden because, I mean, it's only the great families who can really remember who they were back beyond the Dark Ages. I mean, virtually no one can go back beyond that.
Well, that's for sure. It's just, it feels a bit oppressive in some ways, kind of like the caste system in India, you know, that your genealogy would make up who you are. That's one of the great American dreams, I think, is that we break free from all of that and become more than our genealogy.
And yet here I was drawn into connection with this kahuna elder who had 27 generations of his ancestral spirits in constant attendance upon him.
Wow.
They were serving him as his advisors. And I would watch him. I would ask him questions. And I would watch him, you know, momentarily dissociate and go into this altered state of consciousness in which he was obviously listening. He was obviously listening. He was being advised
right.
by the spiritual elders. And so the fact is that all of us have ancestors who care about us. And this is one of the great discoveries that, you know, I won't say I made this discovery, but it's one of the discoveries that happened in our workshops, you know, where non-tribal Western people would discover that they had these ancestors who were kind of operating behind the scenes, so to speak, kind of like helping spirits or spiritual advisors. And once you're in connection with them, life becomes an incredibly enhanced adventure because instead of turning toward a self-help book or a psychologist, you can turn towards your ancestors in spirit for answers about questions which have great meaning to you at this particular time. And this man, Makua, was one of the ones who drew me in this direction.
Well, you know, I do that on a regular and consistent basis. I just had never really thought about or called them ancestors. But so I know exactly what you're talking about.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
Well, it's interesting how the importance of words. So
well, you know, one of the things that Makua and I talked about is the fact that we actually have three ancestral lineages. Now, we have our maternal lineage.
Uh-huh.
Those are our mother's ancestors. We have our paternal lineage, which are our father's ancestors.
Right.
And then we have our own personal ancestral lineage, which comes to us through our higher self. Because the higher self is the repository of all of our former selves, of all of our former lifetimes. We come into life from that source, and we withdraw to that repose at the end of life. This is part of what we talked about, Makua and I, the reincarnational cycle. And when you understand that, it means that in many ways, you are, in fact, your own ancestor, and you will have spiritual descendants who are future selves manifested from the same higher self, sort of Grand Central Station, if you will.
So we're talking basically about the Oversoul.
That's right, Oversoul.
I was introduced to the Oversoul many years ago by Jane Roberts. You remember Jane Roberts wrote the Seth materials?
Oh yeah, and the Oversoul 7 trilogy.
The Oversoul 7, and it was a great book. Really opened my mind. Started me on that with that connection, because that's where I find real truth to lie, is in that connection with my higher self.
Oh, let's put that one out there again for all of your listeners. This is required reading. Jane Roberts, the Oversoul 7 trilogy.
Absolutely, absolutely wonderful reading. And, you know, unfortunately, sometimes some of the really great books get passe, especially in the New Age movement. You know, it's like thirsting for the next one rather than the one that really counts. But that's for sure. Tom will put that up on the chat room, too. And maybe you can put something out there on Twitter, Tom. That would be a good idea.
So
you and Makua really hold initiation as being of the utmost importance. Talk with us a bit about how you see initiation, what that looks like, really.
Well, in order to experience authentic initiation, we have to understand who we are as well as where we are. And it's been my experience in people coming into my workshops for almost 20 years that I have people coming in who are 40, 50, 60, 70 years old who still are in search of initiation, authentic initiation. Now, who you are, who are you? You know, there's a real towering ignorance about this in Western society. Who you are is not what you do for a living.
Right.
It's not who your mother and father are. It's not who your wife is or your husband is or your children are. It's not where you live or what you drive, you know. Who you are is really about who you are as a soul,
right,
traveling across eternity, growing, increasing, and becoming more in pursuit of your personal destiny as well as collective destiny. That's about who you are. And there are several chapters in this new book, The Bowl of Light, which are about this very thing.
Absolutely, yes.
About the fact that we have not one, but three distinct souls.
Right.
Now, this is a foreign concept to people from the monotheist tradition. You know, Judaism, Christianity, and Islam are monotheist religions. They believe that there's only one God, that we only have one life, and that we only have one soul. Well, that's a very nice theory. Unfortunately, it's wrong.
Yeah, it's not true, is it, at all?
In fact, you know, there are many gods. We have many lives spread out across the space-time continuum, and we have many souls. To be precise, we have three very distinct souls, and understanding how those souls function to come together to produce what we think of as the self is the key to understanding who you are.
Well,
in order to experience authentic initiation, you have to understand that. Now, who you are, but where you are as a soul in your cycle of incarnations, of incarnated lifetimes, learning your life lessons, you know, becoming and growing and becoming more than you were, in response to learning your lessons and passing the tests. That's about where you are. And once again, you know, these are areas of investigation which are of intense interest to people in the transformational community. Unfortunately, they tend to get largely passed over in our monotheist traditions, where you go to church every Sunday or you go to the synagogue every Saturday or to the mosque every Friday, and you sort of get the teaching according to individuals who themselves are not visionaries.
Right.
They're sort of reiterating what they themselves were taught by other non-visionaries. You know, the time of the guru is largely over,
in my
opinion, George.
Yeah.
And really, it's now about each person becoming their own source of their own spiritual wisdom, making connection with those inner sources of wisdom and power themselves. This is part about discovering who you are.
That's the only way we can get past the mental anymore.
Well, you know, there's a whole chapter in this book about the higher self.
Right.
It's what Makua called Hale Makua. Hale Makua. Hale, spelled A-U, means time, and Makua means parent. So your higher self, your Hale Makua self, is literally your parent in time, your utterly trustworthy ancestral spirit self. And, you know, in this book, The Bowl of Light, he tells a wonderful story right at the beginning about how each one of us comes into the world with a bowl of light. And that light is a gift to us from our higher self, which divides itself before we come in. And it sends in this seed of light that takes up residence within us as we draw our first breath at the beginning of life. That first breath is what the Hawaiians call the ha, spelled H-A. Ha. It's the ha of aloha.
Uh-huh.
Alo really means face-to-face, and ha is the divine breath of life. So when you say aloha to somebody, you're saying face-to-face with the divinity. It's kind of like namaste.
Namaste, right.
Yeah.
Right.
So, you know, we take this breath when we emerge from our mother's bodies, and we receive this seed of light, this bowl of light that takes up residence within us. And the first thing that happens is that this light, which is sourced to us from our higher self, encounters a distinct and separate soul which is already in residence.
Right.
This is the soul which is sourced to us from our mother and father, the body soul, the soul of the physical body. And this, you know, is the source of what we call the energy body. And it came to us with the gametes, with the sex cells from the father and the mother. In the same way there's a genetic template, there is a spiritual energetic template which is sourced to us as well. So the first thing that this higher self seed of light has to do is establish a good working relationship with the soul of the body, the physical soul. And then between these two, the third soul comes into being in response to life as we live it. And this is the mental soul, the intellectual soul, the soul that Freud called the ego, and that Jung called the conscious mind.
Right.
These are the three souls. And, you know, there's a lot of information on these three souls and how they function, how they come together, or not, as we learn our lessons in our, you know, walkabout here across eternity in this particular lifetime. I think it's the sort of thing that Western people will find very interesting, mm-hmm. because this is drawn from the deep kahuna tradition of Hawaii.
Not only interesting, Hank, but I can, you know, like, I can draw parallels from my own experience. For instance, when you talk about a bowl of light and how he had given you the wooden bowl, which was your bowl of light, and that, you know, we fall in the darkness and fill it with stones, and, you know, how do you get rid of the stones? Well, you dump it out, and you know, laughed about it, I believe is kind of how the story went. I'm paraphrasing it.
Well, you know, when Makua was talking about this, he actually gave us a wooden bowl, which
right.
was symbolic of this bowl of light. And he said, he told us this story, and he said, you know, as we live our life and we step into the negative polarity, you know, when we take something that doesn't belong to us, or when we injure somebody with our words or our thoughts or our deeds, you know, it's like you put a stone in your bowl and some of your light goes out. He said, life is long, and slowly but surely your bowl of light begins to fill up with stones. And he said, eventually we come to the point where there's virtually no light coming out of our bowl anymore. And, you know, as an aside, you know, I'm sure your listeners will appreciate this. As an aside, you know, he said, you know, the great problem in the world today is that the world is being run by men, primarily, whose bowls of light are filled with stones, and there's no light coming out of them anymore, despite what they may profess to be true. So he said, when we come to that point, hopefully we learn what we're doing before it's too late. And then he said, you know what you do then? And of course, you know, I said, what? And he said, well, it's easy. And he took the wooden bowl and he turned it over. And he said, you just dump it out.
You know,
get rid of all the stones. You shed those burdens, all those grudges, all those negative memories and attentions and associations that you've been carrying with you. You just let them go.
Well,
and the minute you do, you're free.
You're clean.
And your bowl of light is filled with light once again.
Hank, I can't tell you how many times I've actually seen that happen with people. There's a transformational movement that's been going on since the 30s in 12-step programs. And you see people come in, and you can see the darkness in their eyes.
Oh, yeah.
And as they dump out through inventories and so forth, they dump out that dark stuff, you actually can physically see the light re-enter their eyes.
Oh,
it brightens up. It's.
I know. The question is, where do we sink our anchor, George? See, most people out there have their anchor sunk deeply in the negative polarity.
Oh, for sure, yeah.
And they would never admit it. This includes a lot of spiritual teachers.
They don't even know it.
I might add that. You know, they would never admit it, but that's where their anchor is. So the goal here is really to pull that anchor up and re-sink it in the positive polarity. It's about moving from the head to the heart. And that's what the whole game is all about.
If you call my number and you get my voicemail, what you will hear is, don't forget to accentuate the positive and have a fantastic week. I think that is so important that we anchor into the positive. I don't think we can get where we're trying to get without doing that.
Well, you know, to be honest and to be fair here, you know, you can find this in all of the world's religious traditions.
Hidden.
It's there.
Yeah, but it's hidden.
It's just that it's gotten hidden
somehow.
You know, it's gotten ignored. You know, for example, in old Buddhism, which is Hinayana Buddhism, there was a great prayer which was reduced to three lines. Embrace the positive, reject the negative, and keep your mind pure. Now, that last one isn't so easy.
No, that last one's very, very much the challenge. That's the challenge.
You know, that's Hinayana Buddhism. That's where the seeker, the spiritual seeker, goes out to walk the universe alone to discover who they are. That's about initiation. But once they discover who they are, and they discover that they are what they've been looking for all of this time, then Mahayana Buddhism changes the last line. And it goes something like this. Embrace the positive, reject the negative, save the many beings.
Oh, wow.
It's about being of service.
Service is the key, isn't it, Hank?
Well, you know, that's the path back, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. Somehow or other, getting out of that self is essential. And we get so caught up in, you know, like, gimme, 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 there's not enough. I want more, 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 more.
Well, you know, my friend Hale Makua, the kahuna, used to talk about this and what it meant to be an authentic chief. And he said, you know, the chief in the positive polarity is all about self-mastery. That comes with a territory. When you become a chief, you become a master. But first and foremost, you have to become master of yourself. And then secondly, the authentic chief is in service to the entire community. You know, from the lowliest street sweeper and dung carrier and their families, right up through all their cronies and their family members and the religious community and the priests and so forth and so on. Everybody is the responsibility of the chief. The authentic chief's job is to assume responsibility for everyone and their community and to create abundance. And you know what abundance is created? Through relationship with nature. Now, isn't that extraordinary?
Yeah, and also I think, Hank, in coming to realize that we're not separate from nature.
No,
that
we never
has
were.
No, it has to come from relationship with nature because we are nature.
We are nature. And in fact, when you get right down to the nuts and bolts of it, nature is the true deity.
Absolutely.
God is nature. And when you abuse nature, you abuse God.
Absolutely. So, and we have, you know, like a political system that abuses nature horribly. I see you say in the book that you have totally given up on the political system as far as making any significant changes. And I must say, I'm in that same house.
Well, you know, I thought long and hard about revealing that because, you know, that's a kind of personal thing.
Very.
And I'll have to say, you know, I've taken a lot of shit. Shouldn't say that.
No, that word is, that's an okay word spiritually right here.
So. You know, I've taken a lot of grief from people who've run all over me with track shoes because I don't like to vote in the elections. You know, it just doesn't move me. It just doesn't move me. I've very quietly decided to practice acceptance and detachment. I accept the world for how it is, and I don't judge it, and I detach from those things that I can't do anything about. And it gets me off the hook.
Well, I also think, Hank, that you do vote in a very powerful way because, you know, this book of yours is a huge vote, and your workshops are votes. You know, and that's where the real change comes from, it's helping people to change on a significant level, you know, to where that's the only place we're going to see any change. We darn sure aren't going to see it in the political system because it's run by big money.
Right. They well, just, I also pay taxes, George, just like you do.
Yep.
That's a form of voting.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So you go ahead.
Yeah, I was just going to say, in a tribal society, I've lived a good deal of my life with tribal people in Africa. In a tribal society, when the tribal chief, you know, takes in taxes, it usually takes the form of things like yams and livestock and
right.
and tools and so forth and so on. Well, the chief just doesn't stack all those yams in a hut where they're going to rot. The chief redistributes them out to the people. It's a system of redistribution. And the problem is that we've got a system which is being set up by the Republicans, if I could put it like that, in which they just want to be the only voice at the table, and they want all the money themselves.
Absolutely.
And they want all the rest of us to be working for them for whatever they decide is so. And, you know, that system is dead. It's going to drive us into the ground. It's going to bring down our whole society.
Well, it's misuse of power. That's what they're after. The money really isn't it's the power that money represents.
Well, you know, without going political, the fact is that the top 2% of the population in this country control $40 trillion.
Pretty amazing, isn't it?
That's amazing.
Yeah.
That's just amazing, and that just simply can't continue.
I'm going to tell you, I was in the real estate business in Fort Myers back in the 70s, and I had a large real estate company, and I used to have the local politicians would come to me looking for support. And, you know, all of those politicians I saw as, they weren't real intelligent. Now, what I see happening on the higher level is that, you know, those who would be president are going somewhere, you know, to somebody else who's much, much brighter than I am with a lot more money. And those people are seeing our president and our congressmen and our senators as being not very bright. And they move them around with their money and their need for power and greed. They control them.
Well, as Makua pointed out in that chapter where we're talking at his office, he said, you know, the only candidates who would even have a chance of getting elected today are already so embedded in the money process that they're not likely to change the system for the better of everyone else. They're already part of the problem. You know, the fact is that we've got a president right now who may be an exception to that rule, but whether he can govern effectively, given the fact that we've got a broken government, you know, remains to be seen. You know, my heart really goes out to him. I feel a lot of support for Barack Obama. I feel support for him for who he is, as well as what he is and where he is, because I can see that very clearly in him. He's an authentic chief, but he's dealing with a lot of lowlifes.
I clearly see that, Hank. I'm in total agreement with you on that.
Yeah.
But I think the deck is stacked, Hank. I don't think big. See, what big money seems to do is they change the characters, but the plan is all the same. I think the Democrats are at least, you know, trying for, you know, the common man, trying to serve people. But boy, pretty tough out there.
Well, this brings us back to the focus of our talk. You know, yep. Makua, the kahuna, and I talked about this a lot. Now, this is a guy who'd been in the military. He'd been in the Marine Corps for 20 years. He'd been in 5 wars. This guy was kind of like a Rambo.
He was a drill instructor guy, right?
He could do everything. He could fly helicopters. He could drive tanks, underwater demolition. I mean, this guy could do it all. And he was very badly shot up during his last tour of duty in Vietnam. But he acquired a great deal of knowledge as well as understanding of how things work through this time in his life. And, you know, it was his opinion that we live in a time where most of our problems really don't have economic solutions. There really aren't any political solutions.
Right, exactly.
There aren't any social solutions. Nor are there any religious solutions, which brings us to the title of your show. In fact, the solutions are probably likely to be spiritual ones. And as people move into and rediscover their own spirituality, everything becomes much clearer. And we have a much clearer sense of where we want to invest our energy and what we want to do with our lives and where we're going to spend time and who we're going to spend time with. And I think this is part of what the whole game is about. So what we've got in our time is we've got increasing numbers of people leaving our mainstream religions and droves because that old-time religion is no longer doing it for us. And they're involved in personal spiritual quests, which often begin with paranormal experiences, which society at large has taught them to conceal, because ridicule is a very strong social method of control.
Peer pressure, very powerful.
Very powerful. Well, you know, when I wrote this book, Spirit Walker, I sort of came out of the closet because here I was a mainstream scientist doing mainstream science in East Africa.
Right.
And here I am writing this book about having visionary experiences at 4 o'clock in the morning in Hawaii after making love with my wife. You know, I mean, you know, I'm sure my academic colleagues had a few mixed feelings about that book.
I suspect they did. Well, you know, this kind of brings us back to what you talked about earlier, and that is about knowing who we are. And your last chapter, in my mind, deals with that really effectively. I've written a book myself, and I have a whole chapter on that. And that is the reality that we are gods, all of us. And even Christianity, you know, if you were of that ilk, Jesus taught that we were gods, but somehow or other, in their need to control, they overlooked that and go past
yeah,
that.
They did. But the fact is that it's true, George. We came into this world as gods. It's just that we don't remember because we had to pass through the veil, giving us a clean start. That's what makes the whole game interesting. We're given a clean slate at the beginning of each lifetime to see who and what we can become. We come in as holy people. And the goal, of course, is to rediscover ourselves as holy people before we check out. And this is really quite an adventure because our culture is so deeply embedded in the negative polarity that a lot of people just simply don't make it.
Well, and the very idea that we're gods to them sounds egoistic when it's exactly the opposite if you really understand what that means. Because
well, you know, I had thoughts about including that conversation at the end of the book because it was about after Makua had passed, after he died,
uh-huh.
and after the ceremony had been done and the myth-making had happened and everything like that. I brought him back. You know, he's back.
Right.
And, you know, I talked about a conversation that we had, just the two of us, man to man, all day, one day about, well, you know, it's almost 10 years ago now. In which we discussed this whole idea that we are actually gods in becoming. And I asked him really to talk about this, and it was virtually the only time he engaged in that discussion at that level of depth. And I hope that people don't find it overly long, but I felt it was important to try to bring forward the major points that he made about how we are actually in the process of becoming gods. And you know, accepting that and beginning to move in that direction and behave like gods, think like gods, speak like gods, feel like gods, you know, that's part of what it's all about.
There's a real responsibility in the whole idea of that.
And part of it is all tied up with the fact that we're creators. See, human beings are the only creatures on this planet who could create a telephone or the house that you're sitting in or the house that I'm sitting in. I mean, the whales and the dolphins, as highly evolved as they are, can't do that. We do it. We will dream. We'll dream a dream of something that we want to create, that we want to bring into being, and then we'll create it. This is a godlike quality. Only the gods create.
See,
what's happening is, through lifetime after lifetime after lifetime here on the physical plane, we're refining that ability in ourselves as creator beings. And we take that ability with us when we return to our oversoul field between lives. And this is how the oversoul field is actually becoming our God self. This means that the angels that people talk about, each one of us has a guardian angel. The guardian angel is your oversoul. It's the one who listens to your prayers, who works in mysterious ways, and sends occasional messengers to Earth, us, who usually get treated very badly. This is something that the kahuna and I talked about at great length. And it's part of the key to understanding not only who we are, but where we are. It's part of initiation.
You know, one of the things, Hank, that kind of keys for me is this, you know, when we talk about being gods, that means we have abilities that are far greater than what we see ourselves as limited human beings. And when I look at, I was watching a thing on a savant who not only can play every piece of music that he hears once perfectly, if you tell him a particular artist, he can play it in that artist's style. But he's completely, you know, like in trouble in the rest of his life. And so, but the thing about that for me is that if that ability is there for him as a savant, then it's part of the human ability all the way around.
You know, I heard somebody say something really interesting recently, and I'll share this with you. But we were talking about the star beings, the star people.
Right.
And how there's a migration of souls who are coming from the stars right now. Makua called them the children of joy, and we talk about them in the Bowl of Light. The children of joy. These are the star people who are coming here, and they're going to be the inheritors. They are very highly evolved beings, like the one you've just described.
Right.
But where are those people? Well, believe it or not, a lot of them are hiding in a place we'd never think to look for them.
And
they're hiding.
The
disadvantaged. They're hiding in those people who are Asperger's or autistic or homeless. That's where these great beings are hiding. And that's the last deep place that we think to look for them.
I've met some of those folks in the homeless. Hank, I'm sure you're right on with that. You know,
it's like an incredible thought, isn't it?
Well, yeah. Well, if they don't hide, they're going to get killed. Because that's kind of how it works down here, you know.
But it's about doing something that Makua talked about, that we talked about in the book. It's really about going from the head to the heart.
Absolutely.
It's really about aloha. And that's what this whole book is about. The power of aloha. The law of aloha. Because it's through that law that everything becomes possible. If you want to connect with God, you want to connect with your ancestors, you want to connect with your higher self, you can only do it through aloha. You can't do it through zeal. You can't do it through scripture. You can't do it through the Bible. Although some people can.
Well, I think it comes from those who really get a hold of the idea that they're servants.
Yes.
That change.
And it's about going from the head to the heart and really developing a heart-focused practice of living your life.
And the feelings of joy that I've gotten have come from two basic areas that I can definitely identify. One is service. When I serve someone, I get a feeling of joy. So my self-centeredness works for me in that. And the other place is when I'm willing to be grateful and in a place of acceptance of whatever is going on in my life. I can manifest that feeling of joy.
Appreciation is a biggie.
Oh, it's huge. It's huge.
The practice of appreciation. It's one of the nice things that I experience when I'm actually home in my house in Hawaii, living with my wife and one of my daughters. One daughter's in California, one daughter's here with us. You know, I practice appreciation every day from the time I wake up in the morning until the time I go to bed at night.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know? And, you know, my life just sort of opens up like a flower as I do this, and I go through my days very joy-filled.
What's interesting is, in order to get to that place, I think we must get to what you were talking about earlier, and that's self-mastery. I had years where I, you know, my battle cry, my mantra was I wanted to be free. I had no clue that I was trying to be free of myself and my own negative feelings and emotions.
One of the things that Makua said, which you probably remember from the book, he said the first lesson is to learn how to listen. And, of course, what he was saying is learning how to listen to spirit. Because
absolutely.
Spirit is actually the one. The second lesson is master your emotions. Now, those two, man, I mean, you know, I work on them all the time. And, you know, I often just fail the test. You know, something will happen. I'll get betrayed to the max by somebody who I trusted implicitly. and I'll go into the dark side of my character, and all of my Celtic ancestors will come out, you know, and I'll think about, you know, hauling out the broadsword and, you know, chopping away.
Right.
And then, you know, I get through it. And I step out of the negative polarity, empty out the bowl, and go back to the rest of my life. I mean, that's the only choice we've really got, isn't it?
Well, you know, Hank, I wonder if that isn't kind of a built-in safety valve that keeps us from our own arrogance. You know, it's, you know, spiritual arrogance is a pretty dangerous place to be. And if I think I'm, you know, I've found my way to perfection, I can, you know, I can get to that spiritual. But I have those momentary lapses back into what you call your Celtic ancestors, and it kind of gets me right-sized.
Oh, yeah. Well, you know, arrogance is one of those tests. You know, we all go through the spiritual arrogance phase where we've suddenly woken up and we think, wow, this is it. Of course, this is only the first step.
Right.
But, you know, we become consumed with the fact that we've made it, that, you know, this is who we are, that this is what it's all about. And a lot of us go into it's a practice of zeal, of enthusiasm.
Right.
And what we don't understand is that zeal is the negative polarity of the sixth level. This is what Makua would call the sixth level, the level of the healer, the level of the priest, the priestess, the level of Lono, the Hawaiian god Lono. The positive polarity is compassion, the practice of compassion, and it's really the only path that's open to us. And when you're dealing with the priest, the priestess, you know, the evangelists, and all the preachers on television on Sunday morning, they're all in zeal.
All of them.
They're all in zeal.
Yeah.
And, you know, although it would shock them to hear this, you know, I perceive them as being deeply in the negative polarity.
Totally. Well, you know, Hank, the reality about love is we cannot be in a real state of love without at the same time being in compassion and empathy. It's not possible.
Yeah. So tell me, George, how did you like this book, The Bowl of Light?
I liked it.
Yeah,
I do. I liked it very much, and I think the key is just getting people aware of it. I highly advise the book. It's not only jam-packed with some real spiritual wisdoms, it's also a good story. And you know, people will read good stories, and that's really important. I think you've done a nice job with this, Hank. But you're a hell of a good writer anyhow, my friend.
Well, thanks, George.
Yeah, absolutely.
I work on it. I mean, it took me 5 years to write this book. And it's a very simple book. This is not a heavy read. It's
nope.
Not a dense read.
But it's written. It's written tight. It's written well. And yeah, definitely. Tom has put it up on the chat room, and it'll be up on our website for sale through Amazon. So we're gonna push it for you. And hopefully.
Oh, that's great. That's great. The job here is to spread the word and create connection.
One of these days, I'm gonna get out there and eat one of your bananas.
You'd be welcome.
I will look forward to it at some point in the future, Hank. And,
okay.
And listen, after 2012, when that next one in that series comes out, let me know, will you? I very much like to follow your path.
We'll all be there together.
I had about a half a dozen other things I wanted to talk with you about tonight, but I knew that was going to happen.
Well, let's do it again.
Let's do that. We will do that. Matter of fact,
maybe this summer.
I'll tell you what we're doing. We're taking off this summer.
Oh.
But this fall, we'll definitely have you back.
Yeah, let's do it in the fall.
Okay, good. Sounds good, because I'd like very much to see your book take off.
Okay, well, thanks so much, George, for having me on.
Thank you, Hank. And, hey, you're at home. You don't have to walk that mile back like you did the last time, do you?
Nope, it's time for a Mai Tai.
Oh, go have a Mai Tai. Have a good night. Thanks again, Hank.
Okay, George. Aloha.
Aloha. As usual, Tom, good show with Hank. Just an excellent show. I can't really, if the Bowl of Light, go give it a try. It's a good read. It's an easy read, and it's full of some information you may not be privy to at this point. Next week, my guest is Lisa Ann, author of No Phone in Heaven. Be sure and come back, and in the meantime, don't forget to accentuate the positive and have a fantastic week.